So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that Jesus is a sinner." Well, he answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" And he answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. What do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Well, then the Pharisees reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." Well, the man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where Jesus comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." The Pharisees answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and you are trying to teach us?" So they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven out the man who had formerly been blind. And when he went and found him, Jesus said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He replied, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one who is speaking with you is he." The man who had been blind said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped Jesus. And Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" And Jesus replied, "If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." This is the word of God for the people of God.
asking for 41 verses of scripture to be read. But I'm really glad we did. Yeah. I can't think of a part of that story I would have left out today. It's just that important. And in fact, it said that this passage from scripture might be the most seamlessly put together passage of narrative and theology that has ever been written. Think of it. Think of it as you read that story again. It's why I think we really needed to hear all 41 verses today. Because even though it's tempting to shorten it up, even though it's tempting to pick and choose a verse upon which to focus, I think we do better service to the realm of God when we listen to the whole narrative and place ourselves in it, even as we place it in us. So as we begin, I invite you to be in prayer with me for just a moment. God, we do thank you for the gift of your word and all its glory and all its spiritedness and all its presence in our daily living. And we pray now that a light might shine upon it that would bring even one person who came today into a sense of new life and new journey with Jesus. We pray that that word of truth might be covered by your glory, and we pray as well that wherever my words are false because of my own human frailties, we might continue to embody that community of grace and forgiveness that Jesus called forth when first he gathered those 12 long ago. We pray in his name. So let's listen together for what the Spirit might be saying to the church today. John the Evangelist was a genius as a writer and a communicator, even if he was occasionally anti-Semitic, as he was in this passage today. You're intelligent listeners, too, geniuses in your own right. So I want to pick the passage apart for a few minutes and see if we can make some sense of it in this Lenten season as we journey through a time of repentance and reflection towards passion, resurrection, and new life. Loads of contemporary scholars remind us that John's gospel is full of symbolism that cannot be taken literally, or else we will lose the essence of the amazing piece of work that it is. For instance, John often calls Jesus the bread of life, but we know that Jesus was not bread. Jesus is called the water of life. We know that Jesus was a man, not water. And Jesus, though he is certainly the light of the world, did not emanate light out of his body, though there may have been a likeness to his life that we could do well to emulate. I suspect and I hope that you're with me here on symbolism. So now let us suppose that the story of the man born blind is equally full of symbolism that we must be careful about taking too literally. Frankly, I think we get more out of it if we accept its symbolic nature. So, at least one writer has suggested that the man born blind most truly symbolizes someone who has always been unaware of what is most essential in life, that being a relationship with the living Spirit of God. The man born blind is a person who never had a vision of what that relationship with the Almighty could look like. So, when the disciples ask Jesus, why was this man born blind? We're invited to hear his answer in a new way. This man is unaware of the most essential things in life. Not because of anyone's fault, certainly not his parents. But this man is unaware of the most essential things in life so that God might come to him in new and fresh and exciting ways as the source of joy and abundance. The works of God will be displayed in one who is ignorant of the ways of God, who knows nothing of them. He gets to remind me a little bit about the last being first and the least being the greatest. And the story starts to echo themes of the gospel that we are most familiar with. God, through the person of Jesus, will take what is lowest in the world and elevate it to the richness of spirit that we have only yet imagined. The man born blind, then, symbolizes all who are the lowest in the world, as well as what is most broken in you and me, in us what is lowest and most needy. But the good news of the Lenten season is that as we seek out new vision in the name of Jesus, the works of God are made known to us and displayed in us. We are elevated. We are invited to wholeness. We are invited to say, with that symbolic man, maybe I don't know Jesus as well as I might. Maybe I don't know Jesus as well as you think you do. But I do know that I was hurting and now I'm healed. I do know that I was broken and now I am whole. I was afraid and now I am comforted. I was blind, but now I see. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. We heard about other characters as we bless the children today. Let's talk about these Pharisees for a minute. We might accuse them of nitpicking in this story. Instead of rejoicing with this broken man who has found a new life, this blind man who has come to see, a person who's finding new vision for daily living, these people can only grouse about how he went about it in the wrong way. Because it happened on the Sabbath, or was against the laws of the day, or was counter to their own expectations about how someone should go about finding new life. One person has suggested that an accomplished nitpicker can pop every celebratory moment. Like this. The wedding was so beautiful, it's too bad the groom couldn't have lost a few pounds before the ceremony. Do you know any nitpickers? Well, someone might say, hey, congratulations on that promotion, but you know, you still have a long way to go before you have the top of the heap. Or, you know, all the work we've done on this church sure looks nice. It's too bad it's not as great as the old days. You see, ooh, I didn't get a well. That's what nitpickers do best. They take the air out of our joy. They blemish our triumphs. They're the ones who say, you shouldn't have found wholeness that way. You shouldn't have come out. They're the ones who say, how can you find wholeness by that approach when it is not our approach? They are the Pharisees in this story. They are the religious in culture in every age. And in this age, the church crowd that so many people are calling irrelevant and unknowing. They are the ones about whom today's spiritual seekers say, there's nothing for me in the church. I don't understand the lingo, the rituals, the cliques, the devotion to traditions that are stale, the inability to see beyond the walls for what the Spirit is saying, not only to us, but to the world. You know there's people out there who say that? These Pharisees are the ones who thought they were lucid. Clear-thinking individuals who understood what must be done to be part of the people of God and part of the religious community. They thought they had a clear vision. And in their conviction that they already know all these things, they become blind to what is real. Their relationship to the Spirit of God is dead. Their sin is that they think everything is fine. Their sin is that they believe they are doing enough. Their sin is that they are blind, but they think they see. Their sin is the death of the soul. Theirs is a church that doesn't pay attention to the spiritual life whenever the people gather in worship, coffee hour and meetings and fellowships and clubs and dinners out. There's just a church that treats spirituality as an afterthought in the business of running an organization and getting things done. We have to get things done. There's just a church that risks forgetting God. In their attention to detail, perhaps in their nitpicking, one might say, they pay such attention to the little things as to miss the big things. They miss the rejoicing. They miss the joy. They miss the personal triumphs. They miss the ever-present Spirit of God that comes to give new depth and breadth to daily living. Their sin is that they won't believe there is anything more to life than what seems real today in this moment. They are stuck. And they can't move forward. They are those to whom the Apostle Paul said, "Sleepers, awake! Rise from the dead, and Christ will shine upon you." So, the short version of this lengthy description might be that this passage in John shows us a blindness that in fact sees, a clear-sightedness that in fact sees nothing. We gain from the story the reminder that when we think we have all the answers, it's quite possible that we have none. When we think we are doing enough, we are probably accomplishing little. When we are certain about our righteousness, we are probably on the verge of being lost. When we claim to know all we need to know about God, we probably miss the point of searching for life's deepest meaning. Church, when we become very attentive to the flaws of others, we're probably not paying enough attention to our own shortcomings. When we think we know how to run a church on our own, we risk closing the door on the God who created it, and who offers to create each one of us anew each day if we will but seek. Finally, we learn that when we are spiritually infirm because we don't know any better, man born blind, God will do great things in us to bring life to light, not only for us, but for all who will have eyes to see. But when we are spiritually infirm because our own vanity makes us think we are strong, then, friends, we are risking our relationship with God. Whole creation. The turnaround that can happen in a person's life, remember, repent means turn around. The turnaround that can happen in a person's life or in the life of a church when they are able to say, "I don't know what God wants from me, but I'm willing to search it out," might be so astonishing a turnaround as to be unbelievable. It surely was in this lesson from John's Gospel. How did this man who was blind come to see? He was never blind in the first place, some said. The turnaround proved to be astonishing, even unbelievable. United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale. Imagine such a turnaround to the God of all creation. I pray for myself, and I pray for you. This turnaround, this repentance, this restoring of sight during these last weeks of the Lenten season. May we so unlearn everything we think we know that Easter can come upon us fresh and new and life-giving, not just a story from the past, but an experience of the present and a promise for the future. So fresh and so life-giving that we will gain new eyes with which to see the risen Christ in our midst, church, and in the world that so longs to be made whole. That one said, "I don't know what God wants from me, but I'm willing to search it out." Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. I pray you'll find home as well.
Let's pray.
If you don't know who I am, I'm Fred. I'm your moderator. And I'd like to call forward at this time our leadership team. And while they're coming forward, I'd like to tell you a little bit about sharing time, talents, and treasures. These people that are on our team are so wonderful because they're volunteers and they actually give their time and their talents. And we have challenges every day with issues that involve the church. But I have to say, of all the teams that I've served on, this team is the best because we respect each other. We respect our differences of opinion. We compromise, and we do what we believe is best for this family. And it's really our relationship, not as a board, but our relationship with you. And it's easy for us in each one of our positions to do things and say, oh, I've got to do that, I've got to do this. But the end result is after you have done it, the hairs stand up on your arm, and you know that you've been blessed. You haven't been blessed by the people. You've been blessed by God because you're carrying out what God intends for us to do. So at this time, I'd like to let each person introduce their position and what they do on the board.
My name is Arlene Colony, and I am the church clerk, and I love it.
I'm Mark Taylor, and I'm the congregational care minister.
My name is Jeff Ruloff. I'm the financial secretary.
I'm Joel Slotnick, and I'm the church treasurer.
Joe Aiken, along with my magnificent team, I'm worship, music, and arts ministry team leader.
Karen Morris, I'm Christian education.
James Grant, Ruth's ministry.
David Alderman, public relations.
Reverend Patrick, I'm the pastor. And blessed every day, every hour, every minute, every second of the week by this team.
And let's not forget Perry's banner.
Oh, yes, Perry's banner. And Jeff Wheeler, our vice moderator. But really, you should work with this team. It's just truly every day is a blessing.
At this time, we're going to install this team, and Reverend Vertigan will do that for us.
So the scriptures tell us that there's one spirit, but many gifts. And the scriptures remind us that the spirit gives gifts to each one according to the needs of the realm of God in this time, in this space, in these days, and in these places. And so these people have been called according to the Holy Spirit, that they might lift up their gifts for service to the whole church community and indeed to the wider world, such that the glory of God might be revealed from without these walls. And that light might shine in places that are still sitting in deep darkness, though the Son of God has come. So I ask you, having heard the call of the Holy Spirit on your life, do you accept that calling, and do you enter upon this office with integrity and the hope of serving faithfully, such that welcome and inclusion and justice might reign for all of God's people? If so, I ask you to say, I do. And church family, do you promise your love and support and care to these being installed? Do you promise to honor their leadership while challenging them to faithfulness? Do you promise to walk with them, behind them, before them, and with and around them, such that while they lead, they might also be seen as servants?
We do.
Amen. You didn't even wait for me to say it. All right. And since you do, we would ask God in prayer to bless this coming together. Will you bow your heads with me? Dear God, we give you thanks for the Holy Spirit that calls forth gifts for prophets and teachers and apostles and servants, for treasurers and clerks and planners and artists, for all the various gifts that you bestow on all of your people, such that the realm of God might be expanded from this place. Bless those who now enter upon leadership. Bless us as we follow and invite them to lead us. Bless us as one church congregational family, that we might walk together in all your ways to the glory of God in Jesus Christ. Amen. And so you are installed. I pray your service will be good and faithful and full of joy for the whole kingdom of God.
you were touched today by God's love and grace while viewing our worship service, and we hope to see you in person one day. We at the United Church of Christ Fort Lauderdale are an open and affirming church that believes in equality for all. We have many ministries that reach out to the needs of those in our community, and there's always something here for everyone to be involved in. We believe that God is still speaking and that our ministry outreach can only continue its vital mission in bringing people to Christ through the support of people just like you. Please visit our website, uccftl.org, for more information about us, to submit a prayer request, or even donate to the church if you have been moved by the Spirit. You will help us in God's work in our ministry outreach. We look forward to hearing from you soon, and we hope to see you next week. May God's peace and love be with each and every one of you. And remember, God is still speaking.